Thank you for joining the Once Changing the World, India's first Future Tech Meets Sustainability podcast. And today I'm delighted and honored to have with me Dr. Pravir Malik, who is a multidisciplinary scholar and a quantum computing visionary. He's the founder and CTO at QIQuantum and is the Forbes Technology Council Group Leader for Quantum Computing. Dr. Pravir has authored 22 books and multiple IEEE articles on his cosmology of light and has a patent pending on a fourfold atom-based quantum computer. He is an IEEE Senior Member and a recipient of the Best Book Award for the Fractal Organization Creating Enterprises of Tomorrow. So Pravir, really appreciate you taking time and being part of the podcast.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I was thinking, you know, if you could start with explaining, you know, how a classical computer works, you know, before we get into the quantum computing. So, because we ground the audience. So, you know, how does a classical computer works? What is Moore's law? And will the end of Moore's law bring an end to the binary computers?
Yeah, so classical computing is based on the idea of basically bits, which is something that, in contrast to quantum computing, it's a media, you can say it's a media that's been developed over many, many decades and it's been tested very thoroughly. There's many ways to create bits, these digital bits, which operate in either a one state or a zero state. And there's been a lot of logic that's been developed. There's a lot of mathematics that's been tested and tried for decades. And so when we look at a classical computer, it's a very well-tested approach. And obviously, we see the applications, millions and millions of applications that just continue to develop. And there's no flaws, the error rates are zero and so on. And so classical computers is something that's been tried and tested. In the Moore's law basically has to do with the compression of, the way I'll explain it is that the compression of computing power in a physical space. And there's a limit to that because once we approach the limits of what's possible to put into a physical infrastructure using bits, then you've, in a sense, reached the capacity of what you can do in terms of computational power with a classical computer.
I think before we get into the quantum computer space, I think it'll be very nice. I mean, if you could explain to the audience what quantum physics is, you know, I mean, so that will be like grounding the audience into maybe making them understand quantum computing better.
Yeah, so quantum physics is just simply the physics that we imagine exists at the quantum level. And there's models and there's insights that we've gained over the last 100 years, and particularly about 100 years ago when we had luminaries from Schrödinger, Heisenberg, Bohr, and then previously Max Planck and Einstein. There was a lot of very interesting insights that were even tested out to a large degree that gives us different insight into how physics works at the quantum level. And some of the interesting hypotheses or properties that have surfaced are things called superposition and entanglement, for instance. And superposition is really this idea that if you have a quantum object, then it can exist in infinite number of states until measured, in which case when it's measured, it collapses into a single state. So that's a property that can be leveraged if we learn how to use that, at least the theory goes, then that's something that the physics translates to a different kind of computational capability. And then we have something called entanglement where we can basically have two quantum objects begin to share properties. And then if we separate those quantum objects even theoretically, you know, infinitely far, and we make changes to one quantum object, it'll be immediately reflected in the other quantum object, regardless of how far it is, and instantaneously. which then transcends, basically what we're saying is that that transcends the speed of light. And so that's another very interesting property that is supposed to be happening at the quantum levels. So when we talk about quantum physics, it's something that's different. And to say that we completely understand the quantum level right now, I think is a little hubristic, you know, in some sense, because, you know, we're penetrating into the invisible and we have some glimpses of how things might work at the quantum levels, but by no means do we know how everything works at the quantum levels or what kinds of other mysteries need to be or will be uncovered as we are able to grapple with it more intimately. So in that sense, quantum physics is an extraordinary window into something that is invisible. And if we were to look at life around us and see the tremendous diversity and where does this all come from, then, you know, certainly scientifically we can say it all comes from the quantum levels. So there's a lot of possibility that quantum physics is giving us a little window into, but there's a lot more that perhaps exists that also needs to be uncovered, discovered, and thought of differently.
You know, when you talk about superposition and entanglement, you know, for a layman, it directly goes into the woo-woo zone. You know, when you say life or everything that we know of, you know, that we can see, perceive, you know, us, air we breathe, to sun, star, moon, universes, everything is just come out of an atom. Through so that itself is something which is so I would want to get into the superposition and entanglement and but I think again, I mean, it'll be great if you could also maybe possibly give out the what are the main interpretation of quantum mechanics, and if there is any interpretation of quantum mechanics that you personally favor.
Yes. And so, you know, before we move forward, also, I wanted to just clarify that, you know, we're not saying that everything comes out of an atom, you know, so when we look at all of creation, but what we're saying is that the atom itself is something constructed from the quantum levels, you know, and so there's other things that also exist in the quantum levels. You know, atom is certainly one kind of creation that has emerged, and a very robust creation at that. But that doesn't mean that everything that's created follows that line of development. There could be other lines of development that are untapped or untouched. And so I'll just leave that as a thought. The most common interpretation is the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics. And that's the interpretation that perhaps has given rise to our current interpretation of what superposition is, what entanglement is. And it's the idea that nature is, in a sense, it comes down to it's a black box. It operates randomly. There's infinite possibility. And it's only the act of measurement that causes that infinite possibility to coalesce into something that can be measured. So that's, in a sense, what the Copenhagen interpretation is. You know, there are other interpretations, you know, like the multiverse, which when a certain path is chosen, or a certain act of measurement takes place that causes conditions or causes materialization to occur in one way, then simultaneously there's also another part that is happening that we are not perceiving that results in a different, in a parallel universe. And there are, from that point of view, infinite number of parallel universes that are created from every bifurcation of choice, in a sense, you know, which surprisingly is also considered to be is an interpretation that's accepted by quite a few academics and so on around the world. The interpretation that I'll focus on is what makes sense to me, and I'm going to just summarize the idea behind it, and I call it the quaternary interpretation of quantum mechanics. And that's also where the idea of QI Quantum, the company that I've created, which is quaternary interpretation quantum, and the architecture of computing that I'm suggesting emanates from this interpretation of what's happening at the quantum level. So very, very simply, the interpretation, we can think about it like this. When we look at manifest life or manifest matter, scientifically, it's known that let's consider life. Your life is made up of living cells. So whether it's plant, animal, human, any living cell has four molecular plans in it, and only four molecular plans. And we know these as nucleic acids, polysaccharides, lipids, and proteins. Right. So there's four structures that exist in every living cell. Now, if you look at atoms, the 108 known atoms, you know, we can also classify all known atoms into four categories. There's S-shell, P-shell, D-shell, and F-shell atoms. And then if you look at quantum particles, we can also categorize them into four categories. There's quarks, leptons, bosons, and the Higgs boson. Now, the question is there a relationship between this fourfoldness that we see manifest as layers of matter and life? Because ultimately, we're talking about the physics, the chemistry, and the biology of everything that has manifested. Because if we're looking at living cells, we're talking about biology. If we're looking at the atoms, we're talking about chemistry. If we look at quantum particles, we're basically looking at physics. And so what I'm asking is there a relationship that we're not seeing that exists between these different layers of fourness that have manifested and created all physics, chemistry, and biology around us? And my interpretation of the way that this fourness has emerged is, yes, you know, there is a connection between these different layers. So I can make the case that if we consider the most granular example of a living cell and look at these four molecular plans, we look at nucleic acids, we know that it has something to do with what we call knowledge, this concept of knowledge. When we look at polysaccharides, we know that it has something to do with this power, that this concept that we call power or energy. When we look at lipids, it creates compartmentalization in cells and creates harmony. So it has something to do with a concept that we call harmony. And when we look at proteins, they're the workhorse elements of the cells. So it has something to do with a concept that we can call service or a presence. Now, if we penetrate a layer deeper and look at the atoms, I can make the case. So if we look at the kinds of elements that exist in S-shell atoms, P-shell, D-shell, or F-shell, that S-shell atoms, for example, you've got elements like hydrogen and helium that we know power suns and create nuclear fusion and so on. So it has something to do with power. If we look at D-shell elements, then these are, in a sense, like the workhorse elements, you know, like iron, nickel, cobalt, aluminum, that create all the infrastructure. So it has something to do with this concept that we call service or presence. If we look at P-shell elements, you know, we have atoms like carbon, silicon, that are responsible for life, for mental life, for computing life in a certain sense. There's different archetypes that exist, like metalloids, non-metals, and so on within that category. And so we can say that there's some kind of concept of knowledge that exists in that category of P-shell elements. And then if we look at the F-shell elements, then we can see that as an experimentation and harmony, because we have at the atomic level atoms that have the highest atomic number and are, in a sense, the most stable and also the most unstable, large experiments in collectivity. And so it has something to do with harmony. So I can make the case that there's a unifying concept that actually connects the way life has emerged, the way all chemistry has emerged. And if we go back to the quantum level, so at quantum particle level, then similarly, I can make the case that quarks are a representation of knowledge, leptons are a representation of power, bosons are a representation of harmony, and Higgs boson is a representation of presence. And then the question is, if all these are patterns are, in a sense, these are fractals of something that must emerge from a root source, where's that root source? So that's the quantum level. So in my interpretation of the of quantum mechanics and quantum levels, there's this fourfold pattern that exists intimately within the quantum level that we're not seeing right now, but that all manifest matter and life suggests that there's something that we're not seeing that exists there. And so in this interpretation, there's another set of dynamics that exist at the quantum level that are, that is responsible for a certain line of development of how matter and life have emerged, right? So I call this the quaternary interpretation. So I'll just pause there.
Right. And what's been the response from your peers regarding this quaternary interpretation of quantum?
So it's not a widespread interpretation, right? It's not. So I've done some publishing. I've written about 12 quantum computational papers for IEEE conferences that have all been published. I've written 10 books on cosmology of light that goes into this in a lot more detail. The readership is limited for both those audiences. But the fact that it's been peer-reviewed by certainly some subset of academics for the IEEE conferences means that it resonates to some degree, at least, or it wouldn't have been published. And I've given numerous presentations in different kinds of audiences. And there's always a mixture of response. There's some folks, you know, some academics who like the idea and see that it's possible, there's a possibility there, and there's some that don't. You know, as with anything, there's a mixture. And I think ultimately the proof has to lie in experimentation. And that's what I'm doing with the company QIQuantum, because I'm on paper, I've filed a patent, I've designed a different kind of quantum computer that would be able to, that would be sensitive to these kinds of dynamics that I'm saying exist at the quantum level. And they'd be able to detect them. And if we're able to detect them, there's a different mathematics and a different way in which computation can arise then. So the proof ultimately will be in being able to build a computational device that can detect this,
right.
which is what I'm doing.
Building a quantum computer is extremely resource intensive. It's like, I mean, you know, some of the largest tech behemoths are kind of doing that. It's basically the Googles, the IBMs, and, you know, some of the D-Waves. And QIQuantum is working on this. You've got a completely, radically different approach. What's the plan? What's the roadmap ahead of putting this together?
The design is, you know, at least conceptually and on paper, is well underway. It's the basic foundation has been laid out. The architecture of how the gates would operate has been laid out. The mathematics that needs to be leveraged, has the foundation of that has been developed. So some of the key elements are in place. The next critical issue is, you know, as you rightly point out, it's resource intensive. There's a lot of investment that's required to build a lab which can create something like this. And so at the moment I'm working on that, is to get the right partnerships in place, the right funding in place. I floated QIQuantum last year. I created an organization for it. I filed a patent last year. I've just begun the phase of now soliciting and getting the right kinds of partnerships in place. So it's in process.
We started with classical computers because, you know, I wanted the audience to kind of get an understanding of, you know, how the classical computer works, you know, the binary with codes, zeros and ones, you know. But right now we're transitioning to, or possibly will transition to, maybe like a quantum computer because of the end of the Moore's law, because, you know, these microchips, you know, we have reached a point where we cannot stack. We've done billions of transistors. We've gone to 2 nanometers or something like that. And we cannot go below that because, you know, the quantum play will come into it, and so we'll move into the quantum computing space, which is, you know, computing with the source code alive, you know, with atoms rather than bits. Would you be able to expand on this quantum computer? What is it? How it works? And who are the top guys in the field who are building out these quantum computers?
Yeah, so, you know, I see different lines of development, different possibilities with quantum computing. And I think that what's being pursued today is a very valid line, and is going to break this barrier that we see with Moore's law if it can be worked out. But it's a very important line of development that needs to be pursued. And if we're looking for faster computation, even computation, you know, we can't say. So right now, when Dr. Richard Feynman put the challenge out in the 1980s that we need to build a quantum computer that actually works how nature works, the question is, you know, how does nature work? And so there's an interpretation of how nature works, which has been the source and development of a lot of what's happening today in the computing, quantum computing industry. So you've got IBM, Microsoft, Google, Rigetti, Quantinuum, whoever it might be, that all are pursuing the development of a quantum computer along similar lines. And a belief of this idea of the Copenhagen interpretation, and that nature is probabilistic and works in a certain random way and like a black box. Now, the way that I see it is that, you know, ultimately, what's happening in the quantum computing industry today is that, you know, we're going below this level, or the attempt is being made to go below this physical level and the limits of it into the quantum level, but doing something similar in a sense that we do at the physical level. So we still want to, you know, compute, say, exponentially faster. We want to leverage the way that we think superposition and entanglement work, and the way that we think molecules, in a sense, process information and create the functionality that they do. You know, we have a certain interpretation, and we're trying to use a reductionist approach to get to that by getting into the quantum level to actually do, in a sense, what we're doing at the physical level, but with some differences. So that's been the pursuit of, in a sense, the quantum computing industry today. If I step back, and you're familiar with the double slit experiment, but I use that as a metaphor, and let me say why. Because if we think about the double slit experiment, you know, the idea was, if I'm not mistaken, this was in the late 1800s. So it's been around for a while when this experiment was done, or perhaps, so, you know, certainly over 120 years ago or so. But the idea was that, you know, you have a light source and you've got this double slit, and then you've got a surface behind that in a sense, records the patterns of light that's coming through. And if you send light out the way that it was sent, you know, by just using a light source or by using the sun as a source, then you see a definite interference pattern that you would expect And you can interpret then that light is a wave, right? But then interestingly, when a single photons were sent through by using a laser as a source, and you had these individual photons going through one or the other slit, when you think about that conceptually, you would expect that there would just be a single, there wouldn't be an interference pattern, but there would just be a single line on the surface behind. But in fact, you find astoundingly that it's an interference pattern at the back, which means that there's some quantum phenomena at play, that light is displaying this quantum phenomena by which even when you project it as a single photon, it's still creating an interference pattern in defiance of any kind of logic that we have in place, you know, to date. Now, if I were to just look at this quantum, this experiment, and I'm going to draw the relationship to the possibilities of thinking about quantum computation from this experiment. But if there's a device that we introduce in this experiment to measure, say, where the photon is going to go, then basically that causes a collapse of this quantum phenomena. At least that's our interpretation. And you know, we then begin to focus on a single quantum object. And that's what the paradigm is in today's quantum computing industry. It's focusing on these individual quantum objects and then trying to reconstruct the interference pattern by essentially using statistics and probability to infer that this set of quantum objects would create this kind of interference pattern. So we're deconstructing this quantum whole and then reconstructing it to imagine that we're still following this quantum phenomena. And that's the approach that's been taken today in the quantum industry. Now, by contrast, if we had a different measuring device that didn't cause collapse, then we would be in touch with the quantum phenomena by which interference happens. We wouldn't be deconstructing that and trying to reconstruct it. And that's the crucial difference. You know, I don't know if I'm making myself clear, but that's a critical difference, is that through the creation of qubits and the architectures that we have in place today, you know, what I think we're doing is that we're deconstructing quantum phenomena and then really trying to re-piece that together to create something faster and that we think is quantum phenomena, but in reality, it's not really the same kind of quantum phenomena that existed, because we're not working with the whole anymore. To work with the whole, we need a completely different way to look at that whole. And it's not about introducing a measuring device. It's about measuring it completely differently. And so what I'm saying is that there's a bifurcation. There's a different kind of quantum computing that's suggested if we even look at something as simple as a double slit experiment. Right. So the point that I'm making is that, you know, we have a certain interpretation metaphorically that is captured very well in how we've worked with or looked at the double slit experiment. And in my assessment, the computing industry is going down this, the quantum computing industry is going down the path of not working with the quantum whole, but working with a reduced observable object of it, in which the whole has, in a sense, escaped us. And what I'm saying is that quantum computation needs to occur so that the whole does not escape us. You know, we need to create a device in which we're working at the level of this quantum whole. We're not working at a reduced kind of measured aspect of what that whole is, because the moment we start working at the level of this reduced object, the possibility of what quantum offers we're not dealing with that anymore. I'm, you know, making a radical point here that it's not about accelerating computational power. It's about creating something completely different. You know, so when we look at how life has emerged or how matter has emerged, it's due to some kind of quantum computation. But we can create a quantum computer that would perhaps create differently. So there would be other kinds of materials that we could materialize, other lines of even radically, say, life that we could materialize. But it would require a different way to think about quantum computation, which we haven't lost touch with, this hole that we see manifest in the double slit experiment.
Quantum physics, quantum mechanics, quantum computing, the entire subject is something which is not very intuitive to us, you know, because the macro world is fair enough. You know, we get it. You know, it's here, I see it, and everything is fine. You know, as soon as you go to the micro world, things get like really fuzzy, really weird. Even when you started the conversation, you spoke about superposition, entanglement. It's something which is not... It's not intuitive. You don't get it, you know, because no matter how much you try to wrap your head around it, these things are maybe mathematically it does, you know, but it's very difficult to, you know, digest this thing. So you know, today, I mean, I like I said, you know, there's various companies around the world who are just grappling or kind of trying to work on these quantum computing. When do you think we'll get a functional quantum computing? And once we get a functional quantum computing, what are the applications you think which is going to like completely change the world?
Well, so I think that if companies like IBM and Google are able to successfully manage this quantum level as a medium in which to do computation and... you know, for example, create quantum states that endure, deal with problems of decoherence where you've got interference that will change the quantum state. If they're able to master all that, which is not easy, then that track of quantum computation, you know, optimistically, we're looking at 10, 15 years or so in my estimate, you know, so that would allow like an accelerated computation to occur in certain realms, in certain application areas. And that's, you know, one way in which development would occur. On the other hand, just hypothetically take the company that I've created and the paradigm that I'm suggesting. If I were able to create a working computer on this concept, then since it's dealing in holes, there's no question of decoherence, you know, so once you create a quantum state, it just endures. The application areas would be different. You know, it's not about manipulating molecules to come up with different materials. It's about working with the way functionality manifests as a whole and influencing that functionality to create a material differently. So it's a different way to create materials, you know. So hypothetically, you know, we may be able to create a material that has unique properties that we don't see anywhere in the elements, and that would be stable and endure and so on. If we were to use the approach that I'm suggesting, which is different, another application area, which can be approached from either avenue, but it, again, it's different. So if we take the approach that IBM and Google are taking and say, we are able to recreate a certain kind of, you know, through understanding how molecules form, a certain kind of molecule that, say, would benefit the healthy functioning of a cell. So it becomes a new kind of medicine. And that's a particular kind of approach, right? But again, there's lots of problems in you know, as we talked about around lifetime of states, the fact that you'd need you know, millions of qubits to create something like that. So there's a long development time. If you take the approach that I'm suggesting, then again, we're talking about creating molecules in a different way by importing or by superposing function into a new form of a molecular arrangement, in a sense. So there's a different kind of, say, you know, suppose it's found that in a cell, you lack the amount of lipids that you need to create harmony in the cell. You know, just hypothetically, there's an imbalance there. So you now create some new medicine that has a functionality of harmony that you superpose on a cell. Then the cell can become healthy, but it's a different way. You know, the application area might be similar, but it's a different way in which it's done. And so that's, you know, what I'm saying is that when we look at the quantum levels, there's many parts of development that we'll find are possible. You know, we've what's caught the imagination of industry today is a particular path of development that I'm saying is not the only path of development. There's other parts of development. Right. It requires to see quantum level differently and to understand there's different dynamics that animate it. It's not just the dynamics that have been honed in on by interpretations like Copenhagen interpretation, but there's other dynamics that we should be able to logically intuit by seeing the way matter and life has emerged, which is what I'm suggesting with QI quantum. You know, the quantum interpretation quantum and the company QI quantum is that we're using the facts of life to understand what might exist in the quantum level. And then we're creating a device to leverage what we think exists there to create differently. So there's, you know, and these are just two examples. You know, I'm highlighting two examples of how the quantum computing industry could evolve completely differently. But what I'm also saying is that if you take the second part, the second approach, the QI quantum approach, where we're dealing it holds, we're not then grappling with the problems of decoherence or the other problems that industry has today, but we're approaching quantum possibility in a different way. And so we would have, hypothetically, a more stable, more enduring, more kind of wholesome approach to quantum computation. Again, right. You know, this all of this has to be experimentally proven, but it's what's at stake here. So
AI is in the hype cycle. What I'm seeing is that I'm invested in VR, metaverse technologies, and it's everything is converging. You know, earlier it used to be just standalone virtual reality, but now virtual reality is underpinning with the Web 3.0 to kind of, you know, be the economic layer for the metaverse. And there's 5G and AI is accelerating. AI is accelerating with, you know, making avatars more intelligent. 5G is making it more lighter and smoother. Do you see AI maybe playing a role in converging and accelerating quantum computing?
Yeah, so I have a point of view on this, you know, which I'd like to share as well, which goes to a similar kind of interpretation of what might be happening at the quantum level. Now, if we think about AI, you know, AI is the way it's currently conceived. It's, you can say, a manifestation or an outcome of human intelligence. The possibilities of what exists in AI is something that has been conceptualized, and we are using certain kinds of logic, certain ways in which we see things. And AI, due to computational power, can accelerate, combine these core elements of how we as humans think, you know, to the best of our ability. We now import that into AI, but it's a child of human intelligence. It's no different. But it's on steroids in a certain kind of way, and it creates what's appears as extraordinary results, because we're taking the best kind of, you know, we're implanting some strong features and then giving it power. Now, if we were to ask ourselves, where does human intelligence come from? And if we think about the human as a, at least scientifically or physically, as a conglomeration of, you know, different kinds of tissues, and tissues as a conglomeration of different cells, and cells as a conglomeration of different molecular plans, a conglomeration of molecules, then also of atoms, of quantum particles, it's clear that all of this comes from the quantum level, right? So what we're saying is that, you know, when we look at an atom is already a complete manifestation of a working quantum computer. You know, it's the most robust example of a quantum computer that exists because it's made from quantum particles. When you inject or you expose it to light or electrons, it changes its state and it outputs something. So it's a computer. An atom is a fully working quantum computer, and it has a certain intelligence that is derived from the quantum levels. So the question that I would ask, you know, in terms of convergence of possibility and what, you know, thinking way ahead, is that all manifestation of intelligence, whether at the atomic level, molecular plan level, human level, all derives or comes from the quantum level. The question is, you know, what kind of intelligence exists at the quantum level? And if we can tap directly into the quantum level, then can we create a different kind of intelligent device that's not the output of human intelligence, right? AI is the output of human intelligence. Human intelligence is the output of quantum intelligence. So if you were to tap directly into quantum intelligence, then what other kind of intelligent devices can we create that would be entirely different from AI? You know, that's one proposition that I just want to surface. And I've written about this, you know, to some degree. So when you talk about convergence, you know, there's two lines in which we can think about convergence. There's the human child of AI, and certainly that's the way we're thinking about convergence right now. We take certain features of the way we operate intellectually, and we put it on horsepower, on extreme horsepower, and then we look at problems and we try and interpret stuff that's happening at the quantum level. So there's convergence over there. There's definitely going to be convergence there. But then there's a different kind of convergence, because if you were to able to build a different kind of quantum hole-based computing devices that can tap into intelligence at its source at the quantum level, then we have a different model of convergence altogether. And that's something that, again, has tremendous other opportunities that haven't been adequately thought about. So I just wanted to surface these as two different lines of...
Thank you, but really appreciate it. Any advice to students who are looking to get into it? Where does he or she start from?
Well, so I think that, you know, we're starting from what's immediately available to one. So there are a lot of resources today on the internet, and just understanding and grappling with the different concepts of algorithms, you know, trying to experiment with Qiskit or Azure or Google's platform that all offer access to quantum computers. That's a great way to start. As with anything, it requires concentration, and the more hours one puts into trying to understand something, the more the possibility and the insight that is captured or encapsulated by the idea of quantum, you know, can reveal itself to somebody. So it's all a question of, you know, what I'm saying is that just take advantage of the resources that you have access to, and begin to master that. And that when that mastery comes, then there'll be other masteries that will reveal themselves. But it's a process.
Pravir, really, really appreciate you taking time and being part of the podcast. We're sitting in a fantastic point of time. I think there's so much tech which is coming into play. Quantum computing, I think, is going to play such a huge role in shaping the future of humanity. Because here we are, so far the human race have kind of created fantastic innovation through a compute platform, you know, where we've been computing with binary codes, zeros and ones. But now we are trying to push the paradigm and see if we can code with the source code of human life itself, you know, the atoms, and what can happen, what applications that can come out of it. I mean, that's something is, once we have a functional quantum computing, you know, there is Google's, there's IBM's, Rigetti, and many others who are working on. I'm sure you will, QIQuantum will possibly build this new paradigm that you're talking about, which is like a complete different interpretation itself. Thank you, but really appreciate you taking time and being part of the podcast. And my listeners, if you like what you see in here, then please press the subscribe button. Until next time, see you guys. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Really appreciate this.
Thank you so much.